everyone. It's Avim, aka the Wildebeest, and Brent on the pre-show. Now, there's something very different with Rusty today. Avim, what's different with Rusty? No. What happens if I lean back? Yes, we no longer have a door on Rusty. There we go. And no, it's not because I crashed it. It's so I can turn and talk to you more easily without my twisting my spine. Short wheel-based vehicles like this are made for people of a midget status and not of 6'4". So now I can play with my legs outside while I drive, and we're right on the northern boundary. We're heading towards the Nkuhuma Pride, slowly but surely, while I'm testing out my new door. And you can also see my very special socks. And there's a very important reason to have ridiculous socks when you live in a camp like ours. If you all have green and khaki socks, you never get them back. They all go into the laundry and everyone's socks get mixed up. But if you have pink polka dot socks, no one else is going to steal them. There we go. See, Vim's got striped soccer socks. I'm not the only one who goes for the ridiculous. Vim, can we see your socks? Oh, there we go. Vim's got very white, unusual looking socks, so no one doesn't get mixed into the morass of green, khaki, black, blue, and all the normal sock colors. Oh, I can see the vultures still, and they're in the tree, which means the lions are more than likely still here. Now, other exciting news is I know a lot of you like Byron, and Byron is back while James and Taylor are on leave. So you're going to have Jamie, Brent and Byron, and of course Steph after the weekend also be back. So wonderful to have Byron with us for the next couple of weeks. Now, of course, I know everyone's very worried about the Nkuhumas, but we're going to go into that in a little bit more detail once we're in our out of pre-show, and I will fill you in on a bit more information about what's happening with the Nkuhumas. And the smartest person in the Safari Live presenting team actually figured it out. Well, as again, we can't be 100% sure just yet. We're going to have to wait for more tests from Ornister Poort. Now, the first of the forcibly retired buffaloes should be coming up shortly. And they are looking like more and more to blame for the Nkuhuma's conditions. And it's not what you think. Okay. Oh, vultures coming off the ground. The lions still haven't even opened this one up. Let's keep moving. Okay. See, now those vultures in the tree like that are not the ones that flew off the ground, so that means the lions might still be around the second carcass. But we're going to have to wait to find out once we go into show.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
And on this beautiful afternoon here in the African bush, we are on foot in a vast wilderness, and this is Safari Live.
Ready. Standing by.
Good afternoon to all of you watching, and welcome on the Sunset Safari. My name is Jamie. Eggsy just tripped over a branch, and I have Eggsy, also officially known as Zunda, on camera with me. And as I said, we are on foot in a vast African wilderness here on Juma Private Game Reserve in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. We are coming to you live, which means that you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I nearly tripped. Or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. I haven't done a bushwalk in a while. And of course, we have the amazing Herbie with us. Oop. Herbie's now on camera, whether he wants to be or not, with his amazing smile. And Herbie, of course, is acting as a security detail for us, essentially because I'm going to be busy talking to you, listening through an earpiece. He's going to be walking ahead to make sure that I don't trip over a buffalo, as I would probably do. Eggsy might spot it, though. Eggsy's got some good bush eyes. And we are heading along with our two safari vehicles. So Byron is on the one, which I'm sure will excite many of you, the fact that Byron has returned. And Brent is on the other. Now, Byron has just gone back to check on the last position. Come here, Egg, sorry. The dwarf mongoose watching us. Can you see them there?
Yeah.
Am I putting you under pressure now?
Yeah, got them.
Got them. Well done. The family of dwarf mongoose. The quarantine dwarf mongoose. The smallest of the African carnivore. And probably the one that is the most comfortable with the presence of people on foot. Short of perhaps the wonderful Queen of Juma, Karula. Now, we've just heard from Byron that Karula has moved from her position from this morning, and she's gone off with the two cubs. So Herbert and myself and Eggsy are going to be making our way back into that direction to see if we can't help Byron follow up and figure out exactly where she's gone. Because, of course, we've got the advantage of moving about on foot. It's actually why I've been striding along. I'm going to keep striding along, I think, so that we can cover some ground. We want to try and get into that area, because if she goes south, she's going to cross very soon. It's not far to the southern boundary of Juma. So we are going to be heading across there to try and help Byron. With him driving around, we'll walk in that general direction. And speaking of Byron, without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, let's go and hear from the man himself.
Good afternoon, everyone. Great to be back. And I have Jandre on camera with me this afternoon, which is very exciting. Hang on a second. I just thought I saw an interesting bird fly up into a tree. Let me just have a look. There is indeed, Jandre. Have a look. Straight through. Have a look at that, everybody. Oh, wonderful. Oh, dear. Now we're going to have to ID this bird. Little goshawk of sorts. And just double check. It would be nice if it could turn around. That's a nice little start. I just saw it fly up into that tree. It could possibly have flown down to catch something. These little birds of prey will catch insects, lizards, as well as little rodents. Fed a complete blank. I think I know what that is, but I don't think it's a gabber goshawk. It's too small, everyone. Sure. You know what? I just need my book. Beautiful, beautiful little bird. Oh dear, my You see what happens when you take a week off, everyone. You forget all the easy little birds and that. A little sparrowhawk. A little shikra, I think. I think it's a shikra. I think that's what that is. It used to be called a little banded goshawk. Just want to double check for you, but I do think that is what it is, everyone. Little red eye and a yellow beak. That's exactly what it's got, those yellow legs. And like I said, it would be nice if it could turn around for us, because you should be able to see some barring on the chest and the front of the body. It's a beautiful, beautiful little bird. That's a nice little surprise. Let's just see if it turns around. Come on. And they're not very big at all. Small little bird of prey. A shikra. It used to be known as a little banded goshawk. So that is the old name, but it has been called a shikra for quite a few years now. Just when you want these little birds to turn around for you, they don't always do what you want. And the last time I was here, 2 weeks ago, I was doing a lot of bird calls for everybody, but I don't really know the shikra call, so I can't do it for you. And usually they've got these, most of these birds of prey have got these high chirping sounds, very high pitched, but I'm not good at that, so I definitely won't even attempt it. Not interested in turning around for us. But what a wonderful sighting, a lovely bird to start with. Isn't that great? We are looking for Karula. We're in the area that that leopard was this morning, the female leopard with the two cubs, Karula and her two cubs. We have checked the last position, and it seems to be that she has moved off, which is interesting. I understand there wasn't too much of the kill left that she did have, but what may have happened is perhaps the cubs dropped the kill and they could have lost it to hyena or anything like that. I'm not sure. We just took a quick little drive past. We saw some water back in the area, but there was nothing, no sign of any leopards, but I am going to be checking this area very, very carefully. I know Jamie and Herbert are coming into the area to help us too, so hopefully we'll get to find that beautiful female leopard and two cubs for you this afternoon. As I said, it's good to be back, and I know the other guys, well, Jamie and Taylor are taking some time off, well-needed time off and some rest. So I'm excited to see what the next few weeks holds in store for me and for all of you. And speaking of all of you and our viewers, a big hello to friends of mine and guests of mine, Christine and Teresa. I wonder who else is there. It's Christine's birthday. Happy birthday, Christine. I hope you are having a wonderful, wonderful day. And it's great that you can watch all the way from New York City, and you can watch our safari and see what we can find for you. So send your questions in. Don't make them too difficult, though. All right, so we're going to carry on searching this area, looking for any sign of the female leopard and the cubs. And while I do that, let's head back to Brent. He's got a carcass that he'd like to show you.
Now, on the sunrise safari, the nkumas were still feeding. As you can see, there's almost nothing left. Whatever meat was left has been picked clean by the vultures. So those vultures were sitting in the tree because they're full, not because they're lions on the ground. And if you look carefully, there's always a good way to tell that there are vultures. Isn't it so nice? No door, I can just step out into the wilderness at will. But if you look carefully, there's always some vulture down, some feathers around. Now, the lions could still be very close by. So I'm just being a little bit more careful as I approach. If the bush starts growling, we know they're still here. And you see there's still lots of flies, and carrion flies and blow flies. Now they've really, really picked this clean. So the only place the vultures haven't been able to get into is where the lions haven't opened up on the legs here. But you see all the flies that are coming out from under the skin. Whoa! Don't touch me, flies. Yeah. But And you have a look, the flies that are vulture, sated. And if you look on the trees here, they're literally just covered in these flies. Well, we're going to keep moving, see if we can find the pride. Hopefully they're not too far off. They might have headed down towards Gallagher Pan for a drink. Now, so I keep searching carefully, but we're also going to have a chat. Let's go a bit slower. Have a chat about what's happening to the Inkahumas. There's no tracks here. And we'll do a little loop-de-loop around this area. And so, the initial prognosis from the veterinary clinic in Onistepoort is that it is definitely white muscle disease. Now, the smartest member of the Safari Live presenters is the one who figured that out, and that is, of course, Jamie. And she figured out, from a scientific reason, we're not saying it definitely is, but that's the initial prognosis, that it is white muscle disease. But why the reason it happened so quickly, and it's also happening to the adults. And I'll go into it briefly, but I'll let Jamie explain it to you in full, since I cannot take any credit. That was all Jamie. She came in and said, I've had an epiphany about why it's happened so fast. So vitamin E, it's a vitamin E deficiency, and you need fat to dilute or absorb vitamin E. Do you see tracks there? Going straight down to Gallagher Pad. Well spotted. So we're gonna start moving our way there. So and that's the reason it's happened so quickly and right at the end of the drought, even though we've had a bit of rain. So there's almost zero fat reserves left in the buffalo. So the lions are not taking on any fat, and it's very unusual for it to manifest in adults, but not impossible. But as I said, I'll let Jamie explain it in a bit more detail, since she is the one who came up with the theory. And it is just that, it's a working theory at the moment, but so far most signs are pointing towards white muscle disease, and it is a natural occurrence in the wild, especially after a drought like we've just had. And it's also a way of what nature's doing to give the other animals, like the buffalo and the kudu and other things, a way to recover. Because if your lion populations are very big while your animals are in that recovery period, it can really affect the populations of your large carnivores. No, that's not a lion, it's a bush. So I know it is very sad and very difficult, and what's that? Elephant dung. But it is nature looking after itself. But also remember, hashtag Safari Live with a bang. Let's go see what he's found.
Well, look at this, everybody. An incredible spot from Gendre. As we were driving around, we managed to spot what looks like little Hosanna, the young male cub, just sitting across on the other side of the drainage at the moment. Don't see any sign of the other leopards, but what a wonderful start for us. That is fantastic. It is a very cool afternoon, but have a look where that little cub is. He's sitting right across on the other side of the drainage, probably about almost 100 meters from where the kill was, maybe not quite 100 meters, about that from where the kill was, and the kill was a little bit further down the drainage line. So it does look as if they finished the kill and they've moved off. I wonder if Karula, the female, if she didn't move off, possibly to go and hunt or look for some water, and she decided to leave the cubs here for a little bit. And they are well fed. There's no need to move them. So I wonder if that isn't what's happened here. And I'm not sure. I'm sure the other little cub is around here. Like I said, I'm not too sure. There could be all three leopards in this area. So we'll definitely sit and spend some time here and have a look to see if we get a glimpse of the others. I'm just scanning around at the moment. This is really, really wonderful. And as I was mentioning, because it's such a cool day, we're very fortunate, because that's why that little cub is out in the open at the moment. Usually if it's very hot, they do tend to move into drainage lines or in the shade of trees and thickets. It's not always easy to spot a leopard, so we were quite lucky to spot that young cub from a distance out in the open. Although when Jandre spotted him, he was on a log and just jumped down and moved off a little bit, but lying beautifully in the open for us. Isn't that wonderful? Now this female Karula has been very, very successful with raising her cubs in the past and now with these youngsters. These young ones are almost 9 months old already, I think. Eight months, almost 9 months, I think, going on, yeah. So they will still have a few months with the female for her to look after them and teach them how to hunt, how to survive. And usually, probably by the age of a year and a half, that's the average that cubs decide to leave the mothers, or that the mothers actually push them off. So it'll be about a year and a half on average. It's a year and a half, and then they will move off and try set up their own territories. Not the young males just yet. They will be nomadic and move around until they get bigger and old enough, like this young male will have to do when he gets a bit older, and then set up a territory for himself. What I'm going to do is just roll forward a little bit here, just so we can make sure we see that beautiful face of that little cub. How's that, Jandre? A little bit better? hiding in that little cap for us. The nice thing is that because we've got the camera, we're able to really get you up close and personal with these beautiful animals without having to drive right down into the drainage lines or the thick areas. We can show you from the road sometimes, which is a wonderful benefit. And don't forget, everyone, send us your questions at hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email us with questions at wildearth.tv and we'll gladly answer them, or your comments. It's always nice hearing from our viewers. So MJ, you say this is definitely Shongile. So I know a lot of our viewers do view the spot patterns a lot easier than what we do from a distance. I haven't been able to see that little cub properly. It is quite a distance from us. So we'll have a good look out and see and make sure. And just double check. I'm not sure. I still don't see any sign of the other one around. So Shongile is the young female, and I'm just trying to have a good look. Now I know last time I saw these little, well, it was about, what was it, two weeks ago. I saw all three of them together, and you could see the young male was quite large already, almost the same size as the female. The male leopards do get much larger than female leopards. They'll get to the size or weight rather of around 70 to 80 kilograms, which is double the size of the females. Females will get to about 30 to 40 kilograms. So You should generally spot a size difference quite easily with the older leopards. But sometimes it still takes a trained eye, and you do have to look very, very carefully. Now with these younger leopards, it's a little bit harder, especially from this distance and this angle. Lael, all the way from Washington, you wanted to know if leopards can get the white muscle disease. Now, Lael, I know there's been so with me being away, and that I've heard about all the issues with the lions and the lions catching this terrible disease, which is very, very sad. I don't know anything about that disease in terms of if cats like leopards and that can contract it. If the lions are able to contract it, my guess would be that leopards can too. However, leopards adapt very well to different conditions, whether it be drought, different terrain, different areas. They're incredibly interesting big cats, and very, very well adapted to each and every situation and surroundings that they are found in. My guess is that leopards would find food in different areas when there's a shortage of nutrients. I mean, if we know that they hunt everything from fish and snakes all the way up to large antelope. So I would think that leopards would probably get enough food and nutrients that basically they won't get that white muscle disease. That would be my guess, but I'm not too sure. I've never seen or heard of white muscle disease in big cats before. This is the first time that I've seen it. So it's very, very interesting. Jamie actually has a good theory on this white muscle disease. So I think, why don't we head to her and she can tell you more about it.
Well, I hope I have a slightly better, well, not better understanding. I hope that I've managed to sort of clarify my own thinking. And Brent mentioned that I had an epiphany about this whole thing, which is why I'm so casually leaning against the marula tree that's just happened to conveniently be placed here, because this is going to be a long one. So everybody strap in, and I apologize for the science that we're going to go into. No, actually, I don't apologize for the science that we're about to go into, but we are going to go into some science in a little bit of detail. I was sitting on the couch, trying to switch my brain off and stop thinking about the lions and what was going on and just relax a little bit, when suddenly I flashed back to high school biology, and I cannot remember what year I was in, but of course I went to an all-girls school, and we talked a lot about fad diets and why they're bad for you. And I remember very specifically, this was all part of a conversation about vitamins, very specifically having a question in a test that said, why do we need to consume some fats in our diet? And then I remembered that vitamin E and vitamin A, actually, vitamin E, vitamin A, vitamin D, and vitamin K are all what's known as fat-soluble vitamins. Now, vitamin, and I apologize, most of you will know this, but let's just go over it again just to sort of build the story. This is my theory, by the way. It's not based on any chats to vets or anything like that, but it just makes sense in my head. So a vitamin is essential to the way that a body works, any organism, and it's something that we cannot produce ourselves. It's something that we have to imbibe through our diet. And some of them, things like vitamin B, are what's known as coenzymes. So they're organic molecules that help all of the metabolic reactions in our cells. Vitamin E is very much an antioxidant, and it also, it's not fully understood exactly what role it is that it plays, but it's understood that it actually performs a huge amount of very important functions in an organism's body. And it only really needs to be present in relatively small amounts, because vitamin E is fat soluble, and therefore your body can store it. It's one of the reasons why vitamin B and vitamin C supplements, if you keep taking them over a length of time, you might actually end up wasting your money, unless you've been specifically told to by a doctor. They're water soluble. You just excrete them. So, bearing that in mind, vitamin E is fat-soluble. The only way that it can be absorbed through the intestine is when it is included within a fat, because it's actually an alcohol. Alcohol is fat-soluble. It's included within a fat that is then absorbed, physically carried by the molecules within the cells through the cell membranes in the intestine and into the lymphatic system. So why does this all matter? Well, my epiphany, in theory, was it's not about a lack of vitamin E, I think. I think it's about a lack of fat in the diet, and that is why Karula and her cubs and the leopards, yes, they could get it. If you fed them on meat that was completely devoid of fat, yes, eventually they would get a vitamin E deficiency. But with the lions, they've been targeting the buffalo. Now, herbivores are specially adapted. They eat the plants, so they get the oils that they need to digest vitamin E. So it's okay. It's not that the buffalo don't have vitamin E completely. They do. But the buffalo have been the hardest hit by the drought. Therefore, they are the thinnest animals out here, and that I don't think any of us are going to dispute. The buffalo have been hit the worst. The lions are tackling the buffalo because it's easy. The Nkumas haven't needed it to struggle too hard to catch them. The rest of the animals, the mixed feeders, they're in better condition. They're faster. They're running away. So, taking a deep breath. Sorry, Eggsy. I know this is very, very exciting for you. So, it makes sense to me that what's happened with the Nkumas, and that explains, because I couldn't understand how a vitamin deficiency, which is usually quite a drawn-out process, why did it happen so suddenly? And I think we just got to that point where the buffalo used up every single part of their fat reserves, from any fat that they had stored in their organs, subcutaneous fat. And now that I think about it, when you look at the carcass and you look under their skin, there was hardly anything there. So that's what I think has been happening with these lions. That's why the females were getting it. And bear in mind, it's storable because it's fat soluble. Therefore, their bodies had it stored up and they just reached the point where they just didn't have any left and they weren't getting any in their diet. The milk production carried on, but without vitamin E. The cubs went first, but not by much, because remember, vitamins are such a crucial part of our day-to-day existence. If I were to take away your vitamins completely, that you didn't have any in you, you'd become incredibly weak incredibly quickly. And that, I think, is the explanation as to why this white muscle disease has happened as quickly as it has. It makes sense to me. Yes, exactly. Exactly, Jen B. That's exactly what I'm thinking. So if they'd killed the hippo not too long ago, and the hippo also not in fantastic shape, but the hippo slightly better off than the buffalo, then yes, I think that might have been something that would have started to help save them. Look, it might have been that the progression of the disease was such that it was already getting to that point where it just hit that tipping point, and that's when they started to fold. But the good news is that, to me, it makes sense that it's something that's imminently fixable. If the rains continue, you've seen how green it is around here. Herbie and I were just having this conversation about how walking now is not the same thing that it was a couple of weeks ago, because the vegetation is so much denser, we can't see nearly as well, which means that Herbie sort of has to stay a little bit closer to us. He can't necessarily leave us behind and go scouting because we can't see into the bush. So yes, I think that if they'd eaten the hippo, but if the buffalo start to gain condition quickly, hopefully, or if the Nkumas start to kill other animals, it's going to take a while. It's like trying to fix scurvy overnight. It's basically almost, in a way, comparable, though I suppose vitamin C is water-soluble. But don't you think that makes a lot more sense? I know it's still tragic, and it doesn't take away one second from the tragedy of what's happening. But it's been bothering me. I couldn't understand how it was happening all at once, how they were... It was like there was a pathogen, but without a pathogen being involved. Now, Kitty Kitty Bang Bang, you wanted to know why it's called white muscle disease. And the reason is very simple, and it's one of the reasons why the preliminary autopsy, it's not complete, the conclusions are not completely drawn, but why the preliminary autopsy points to white muscle disease. And I've seen the pictures myself. I mentioned them this morning. I'm not going to be showing them because they're exceptionally graphic. But essentially, you've seen what a buffalo carcass looks like. You've seen the way that the muscles are red, the meat is red, the flesh is red. In this disease, the muscles are white, almost complete. Well, they're actually yellow, almost sort of chicken-coloured in... Sorry, distracted by Herbie, who's eating Bushman's grape. Hey, Herbie? It's Bushman's grape. Yes. Spot on. I'm distracted. What are we looking for? Berries. Ah, and a beautiful moth. I've seen this moth before. Isn't that gorgeous? Well spotted, Herbie. Isn't his eye incredible? just while we're wandering along, that he saw that from where he was. Absolutely beautiful. There are so many different types of moths that I don't know off the top of my head which one this is. I know I've seen it before. It's almost velvety and very fluffy and white. Beautiful. Eggsy, would you like a Bushman's grape? They're not ripe. I don't think they're going to be very nice. Maybe just nibble the flesh a little bit. Oh, yuck.
That's right.
Ugh. Sorry. They're meant to be quite nice when they're fully ripe. Puh. That was revolting. Ugh. Yuck. That was truly gross. I understand now why James pulled such funny faces. Yes. Okay, so back to that whole conversation. Diane, you wanted to know if white muscle disease could have killed the buffalo that were already dead. My suspicion is no. I think they have... Look, it might be part of the malnutrition, so they might have a slight vitamin E deficiency. They might as just part of the entire malnutrition that they've been subjected to. But I doubt that was the primary cause of death for the ones that have died without any explanation. My suspicion would be that that is just pure malnutrition. What, of course, happens is the heart muscle starts to get weak and the buffalo dies of some kind of complication resulting from the fact that they just don't get the nutrients they need. The reason I don't think it's specifically vitamin E is because of what we discussed earlier. So the fact that plants, herbivores, are adapted to get vitamin E and oils and the fats that they need from the plants themselves. So seeds, legumes, the plants actually carry certain oils that are basically unsaturated fat that works just as well as saturated. Doesn't have to be a lard of fat or butter to get the vitamin E to digest. So I doubt it was the vitamin E deficiency. And look at what the meat looked like, the muscle looked like on the buffalo. It wasn't white, it was pink. So it makes me think it was something else, probably just general malnutrition that killed the buffalo. So there you go. That was a lot of talking. So there you go. That was my theory. I hope it makes sense to you and perhaps helps you a little bit to understand the way that this disease or deficiency has progressed in the way that it has. And it gives me hope, personally, because it means that it should, as soon as they start getting fat back in their diet, it should help. Right. So I don't think leopards will get it, because they eat better food. Let's go over to Byron, have a look at a leopard.
I think it's a very sound theory, Jamie, and look what we found. We managed to find another leopard down here. I think it's the young male that's down there. Again, it's actually very difficult to tell, having just seeing a bit of the head like that with it lying down. It's, I mean, if Gendre zooms out, you'll see, let's have a look at where this leopard is lying, right down in the drainage line, everybody. See, look at that. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. So from where we are seated, it's quite difficult to spot, but managed to spot the leg out in the open a little bit, and the head, and a little bit of movement from that leopard now, but right down in the drainage line. As I said earlier, they do prefer lying in the drainage lines in the thickets. It's a little bit cooler, and also they don't like to be seen a lot of the times. They're very elusive cats, so this is a perfect position for this leopard. No sign of the mother yet. Well, at least I think so. I don't think that is the female. I don't think that is Karula. I think that is possibly the young male, and the one that we did see earlier was the young female. Maybe.
We've done a big loop around the whole area where those lion tracks have gone in. Now, they haven't come out. Now, as most of you know, I have no problem tracking lions and leopards on foot, but we're not going to be tracking the Inkahumas on foot at the moment due to their condition. Now, a healthy lion is a completely fine thing to walk on foot. Sick lions, and especially where you've got certain members of the pride, like cubs that are sick and adults that are manifesting symptoms, but some are healthy, walking them on foot, they could be a lot more aggressive. Their stress levels might be up, so I'm not going to do that at all. So I'm going to try still keep looking for them, but I'm not going to follow those tracks on foot into the bush, especially at the moment with sick cubs and stuff like that. I could get a very, very negative, aggressive reaction from the rest of the pride. So I'm just going to be a little bit careful. Now remember, hashtag Safari Live for any questions. So if we get no luck with the Inkahumas, we'll go bumble about, see what else we can find. Now I've just got a report that there's a big pack of wild dogs, but they are unfortunately to the north of us. But I will be keeping my ears open to see if they do come to decide and to visit us on Juma. Okay. Now we're just going to go back to those last set of tracks that VM saw. And of course there's a chance, I mean we've lost, we think for definite 3 cubs so far, or possibly 4, we're only seeing 5 at, oh no, yeah, fine. Math's not my strong point. Yes, we've lost 3 definitely. There were 5 this morning. And I'm not sure whether they're all from the same litter or not. But Richard in the UK is wondering, well, will that female continue to lactate? Oh, we drove here 2 minutes ago and there wasn't a lion. Now there is a lion in the road. Richard, sorry to continue to answer your question. She's not going to continue to lactate. She's going to definitely probably go into estrus. Now she might, and there's the rest of the pride. I've spotted some more of them through the bush. That's very strange, hey, Vim? We were here 10 minutes ago and there wasn't a lion in sight. Now I wonder which male this is. Could this be Tinyo, the tooth, who's been trying to sneak in there? And we got to see him fight with Mfumo, I presume it's Tinyo, recently. So, just try to see if I can find a way around him. Cubs look like they're actually, some of the cubs look like they're coming towards us on the road. Now, as we pass on the right-hand side of this male line, we should be able to see immediately. It is, if it's Mfumo, I think it did look like Mfumo. Let's see when we get around. Ooh, lots of big stumps here, we've got to be careful. Hey, Mfumo. Sure, look how much, is that Mfumo? Yes, look how much that wound's even healed since the last time I saw him. Isn't that incredible? Looking much, much better. So it is the authority. He's looking on quite high alert. He is turning into a magnificent beast. I also heard that. It sounded like something behind us that he heard as well. Could be another lion. It's quite thick, the bush behind us, so we can't really see. Let's just... You see one?
No.
Male.
No, female.
Oh, so there is another lion. I did hear something. VM spotted one. Oh, she's coming towards us. Well spotted, VM. I just heard that... Oh. So... Richard, in case you missed it, as I just said, she's not going to go, she's not going to continue lactating. She's more than likely going to go into estrus, but because if she is affected by something like white muscle disease, that might put her estrus cycle on hold. There we go. Who is that now? Is that one of the mothers? looks like. I remember seeing that scar. Just trying to remember now. On her left flank. Can hear the cubs. Let's just see what she does when she sees the authority. I'm sure she's seen him. She might greet him. Belly's full of buffalo. What they really need to catch is a hippo. Well, no, no greeting for you, Mr. Authority. Okay, let's go see where the rest of the pride are. Oh, they're on the move. They've come out from the bush. So amazing that we've just done a loop and in 10 minutes where there were no lions, now they're lions. Stations located in Coomer Pride, they're now heading south on Gallagher Shortcut. Here you go. And you don't get many tracks fresher than that. Oh, that cub has feasted. Look at how full that belly is. Oh, shame. There's another one of the cubs. It's not looking too well. Coming through there now. You can see how, even though it's been eating on buffalo, very skinny, and you can see that distortion in the hips already. Now, guys, I know we don't know what we're going to find while we follow the lions, especially with this disease. There could possibly be more injured cubs that are not looking well. So if you are feeling a little bit sensitive, or you are very sensitive, it might be a good idea to just not watch for a little bit. Oh, hello, big boy. Now, the males are still looking in very good condition. And I know they have eaten some giraffe and hippo while they've been out of our traverse area. So that could be the reason. But so if you are a bit sensitive, maybe just not watch. We are going to stick with the lions. I am going to see where they're going. And so far I can see 3 or 4 lionesses. I'm not sure how many cubs yet, but I will keep following them. No more coming. Oh, more coming from the rear. Who is that now coming from behind us? It's another adult lioness. Looks like Amber. Oh, you can see that. Oh, shame. You can see those, her back legs. Struggling a little bit. Now, as Jamie said, there's always a good chance they can survive if they start catching some other prey, as long as not all the lionesses are manifesting this, as long as there's some lions that can still hunt. Oh, it's so sad. I know we're not supposed to have favorites, but Amber Eyes has always been a favorite of mine. You see that splayed walking. There's a much, 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 much stronger chance for the adults to survive. Oh, look, bam. Look at that, he's playing with Dad. See, some of the cubs seem still completely fine. That's a shame, that one not so much. Now, as hard as this is for us to watch, it is nature looking after itself. And after the drought, if the lion populations exploded, it would have a rather large and detrimental effect on the herbivore population. So this stuff does happen. It's just really sad that it happened to have happened to our pride of lions that we've come to love so much. The authority causing a roadblock. There we go. All five lionesses, it looks like. I can see four. I thought I saw a fifth adult beyond. I'm not sure. Now, Anne has brought up a very good point. Is this affecting any other lions that we know about in Kruger? Well, it does, and that's how we actually got onto white muscle disease. And to the north of us, there's a pride of lions that's going through the exact same symptoms, the exact same things, and have been tested and whatnot, and we're positive for white muscle disease. Lots of greeting. And you can even see, look at that. Look at the size of that lioness. She is glutted on that buffalo, and she looks to be in good condition. She's not showing as many, well, not showing those symptoms like some of the others. It's always a very difficult thing to watch, but the adults, which was what Paul was wondering, the adults have a much better chance of recovery than the cubs, and they'll be able to pick up condition a lot quicker. And I know this might sound horrifying to a lot of you, but it's probably the truth. The fact is that if the cubs died, the adults would stand even a better chance of survival, not having to produce milk. So they would keep on a lot more of the fat, and which would enable them to retain the vitamin E. Now, Mr. Mfumo is blocking us from going any closer. Here he is, he's lying right in the road. And he does have the fluffiest of fluffy tails. Like a makeup brush. Oh, there he goes. Using it to keep away all the little biting flies, not very successfully. Let's move around the authority and try to get to the girls. Sorry, but just a branch. Oh, he is looking quite grizzled. I do love a male lion who's got some good scarring. It's a proper wild male line when you can see those different battle wounds. You won't find those in zoo animals generally. And they don't really have to fight for their food. And most of them are under contraception. So not real need to fight for the ladies either. Okay. No. Okay, well, we get into a spot to have a look at the rest of the pride. Let's go see how Jamie's walk is going.
I'll just look and have a look at this. Herbie has just found me a cup. A beautiful cup that has come from the massive dead marula tree that is just a little bit off to my right. And what's happened here, and I'll show you in a moment, so that the growths that grow on marula trees, basically aborted branches or broken branches that the bark has grown over. But in this particular case, it has formed the most perfect cup to drink water out of. So we've cleared away most of the sand. You know, there's still a little bit there. But all in all, it's absolutely fine to drink from. So if one ever happens to find oneself without a drinking vessel, I would be absolutely fine. Now, Herbie's very kindly provided me with his water bottle. Obviously, I could just drink from the water bottle, but that's not the point of bushwalk now, is it? So of course, if you were desperate to try and find some water, and you actually wanted a way of storing water, this wouldn't be necessarily the best storage facility, but it would allow you to carry, or possibly even collect, especially if you collected different ones, possibly enable you to collect and then store water in the shade somewhere, possibly even bury it into the ground so that it stays nice and cool. Sounds like a proper cup, doesn't it? Right, so obviously I could just drink from the bottle. Suspend your disbelief for a moment and pretend that I have first sieved and then boiled water from the pan, which I have not done, but pretend that I have. And I'm now going to drink from the chalice of marula bark. Actually tastes really nice. It tastes like drinking water from a mountain stream. It sort of imbibes the flavor of marula tree at exactly the same time. Would you like some, Eggsy? You'll get some afterwards. And the nice thing about this, of course, remember, marula trees, marula bark, and the cambium layer of the inside of marula bark, which is now slightly dead, to be honest, but it's this stuff that comes off the edge of it. Now, marula cambium layer is actually used as an antihistamine. Now, I'm not sure how much of the antihistamine properties you'd get from drinking water from a chalice such as this, or a goblet. Perhaps a goblet is a marula goblet, is perhaps a better word, a better way of describing it. I'm not sure what antihistamine properties you'd imbibe, but I guess it's worth a shot if you happen to find yourself with an allergic reaction. Perhaps you've been stung by a bee and you've got a swelling. Might be worth trying and having a drink of it just to see whether or not it helps to reduce your discomfort or swelling. It's a little sandy, I'm not going to lie, but other than that, it's absolutely fine and absolutely hygienic to drink from. There's really nothing wrong with it, so I'm chuckling at the smile on Eggsy's face. It's really nice. It is not, however, the only thing that I wanted to show you, because Herbie's just taught me something fascinating that I did not know. I did know about the spikethorn seeds that I know that local people crush up and throw into sort of small water areas to poison the fish. And if I remember correctly, it's got something to do with the oxygen levels in the water or the way that the gills of the fish take in oxygen. I can't remember exactly what it is. I know that afterwards you have to cut the gills away before you eat the fish. Obviously, it's not something we have to do here, but of course, for many, many hundreds of years, people have lived off the land. And the reason I'm bringing this up, I'm going to keep this water. Should I balance this water chalice? Goblet, it's marula goblet. Stay there, goblet. The reason I brought this up is Herbie's just pointed out this spikethorn seed, on the ground. Now, this is it. This is half of a spikethorn nutcase or seed shell. You can see if I flip it over, can see it hollowed out. It's obviously old. It's collected a lot of mud. Now, what Herbie's just taught me that I had no idea is that it's actually used as a, correct me if I'm wrong, Herbie, it's almost like a divining method to tell the future and to create those sorts of magics within sort of local culture and belief. And apparently what happens is Sangomas carve out numerals, like Roman numerals, into the top of the seeds, and they'll throw them along with the bones that they will then read the messages that have obviously come through from the ancestors. Yeah. So essentially what you'd get is, I'm sure maybe some of you have seen it in movies. It's of course not entirely a true representation, but it does give you a vague idea. You'd have a handful of bones. Each one of these is collected separately, and Herbie says they number up to 6. Will be the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Gather it all together in a handful and cast it, preferably if it lands that way up. Herbie's laughing at me with his head in his hands. Cast it and then divine whatever messages happen to have come through from the ancestors, from how the bones have fallen and the way that the seeds are fallen. It's essentially like the equivalent of tarot card reading. It's basically the same thing. If you happen to go to a tarot card reader and they're the Joker and the, I don't know, the lightning struck tower or whatever it is very interesting. But that is something that I had never known, and that's one of the reasons why we love working with Herbie. Oh, I think that Eggsy's going to have to take a chance to put the camera down so that he can drink from the Marula goblet of water. Sounds like a Harry Potter book. Harry Potter set in Africa. In the meantime, let's go over to Byron, who's just driven past us, find out where he's on his way to.
And look what we've managed to find, everyone. A beautiful little scrub hare. Isn't that fantastic? Well, they're usually nocturnal, but this little one is hiding. It was hiding in the scrub a little bit, and just a bit of the movement caught my eye. It's come out for us, which is quite nice. Look at that. So it was hiding in there, just off to the left, and it's come out a little bit. And again, I think because it's such a cool afternoon and cool day that it's decided to move around and probably try and forage for some food. So we're at the Juma Dam, or the Vuyatela Dam, that's just on the other side, down on the below the dam wall, and there it goes. Beautiful little scrub here, isn't that wonderful? So that's a nice surprise. And what was another surprise, and for me especially, so I've been away for a while, but Jandre and I just heard a woodland kingfisher. Now, I don't know if anybody else has heard it in the last week or so. So Jandre says no. Hey, Jandre, you don't know of anyone else? So maybe the first woodland kingfisher. We've heard it. We haven't seen it yet. So that would be wonderful. That would be wonderful. But we definitely heard it calling. Who knows, we might see one fairly soon. That was a nice surprise. So it'll be interesting to see if anybody else has heard one or seen one, but I think that's the first one. But we have to see them. You know, we've had these little bets to see when the first woodland kingfisher will be seen, what day. I'm not sure what everyone's dates have been, actually. I can't remember now. I must have been the 19th. So it could be interesting to see. Sure. Oh, look at everybody, these beautiful impala right next to us. And this is why I've stopped at them is because, I mean, firstly, it's always wonderful to see and appreciate the impala, but we know that we're expecting some births very, very soon. Marie, you want to know if there are any baby impalas yet, and I have not seen any. That's why I wanted to stop and just have a look around. All these females do still look very, very pregnant and plump. Have a look at those bellies. They are very swollen. So very, very soon, these female impala will give birth. Hopefully very, very soon. Um, I'm way off. I think I said the woodland kingfishers would arrive on the 4th of November. That's what Rebecca told me. I can't remember. It must have been 4th of December. No, so I was very early with that. And then I think I said the 11th of November for the first impala lamb, and that's also obviously very wrong because we're now on the 19th and still no lambs around. But as you can see, very, very soon, I'm sure there are going to be some impala lambs bouncing about. That would be wonderful. There's a lot of green grass and that for these impala at the moment, so the food is good, the water is good, ideal conditions for them to give birth. So I'm pretty sure that very, very soon we are going to see some impala lambs. Would be wonderful. Would be wonderful to see the first lamb, wouldn't it? And so everybody, just an update of that leopard sighting that we had. We unfortunately were having some technical issues. Our signal was fading quite a lot, and you're cutting out. But the little female was still just lying up on the side of the drainage line, little Shungile, and I think little Hosanna, the young male, I think was still the one that was lying in that drainage line. So we left them. Also, I don't want to put too much pressure on them with the mother not being around, but we fortunately did get a lovely view of them, and I'm so glad we got to see them. I think perhaps is possibly off hunting. We know that she's a very, very successful hunter, and that's what makes her a successful mother. She provides a lot of food for these animals, for her cubs. And that's why they do so well, which is great. Can hear a red-chested cuckoo calling, everyone. Let me see. Oh, it sounds quite far from us. That beautiful... You should be able to hear it, I'm sure. In the tree line somewhere in that area. I'm going to drive a bit closer and who knows, let's see, maybe we can find the bird. It'd be great to show you a red-chested cuckoo, one of my favorite birds in this area this time of year with them calling. While I do that, let's head back to Brent and see what those lions are up to.
We're still here with the Inkahumas. They've settled down a bit right next to the road. A couple of the cubs are lactating on one female. The rest are just sort of sleeping here. I don't think they're going to move too much. And we're probably not going to spend too much more time here. We're probably going to go see what else we can find. And maybe Rusty's got a bit better signal where Shungile and Hosanna are hiding. So we might make our way there. It is so difficult to watch a pride we've come to know so well in a situation like this. And it's really important to... And it's difficult, it's really difficult, but it's very important to step back and to just remember that as much as we love the Inkahumas, and if we look at the rest of the lions in the Kruger, and the vast majority of the lions are doing fine, and there's only two prides we've heard about with the white muscle disease. And that's Mother Nature's way of just righting the balance after a serious drought like we've just had, and giving animals, and obviously the buffalo in this area must have been particularly hard hit. And maybe they weren't as hard hit, and maybe there was more grass in other areas. So we've got to look at the big picture. Although as difficult it is when we are with these lions almost every single day. Whew. And we are here to witness nature in its beauty, and its sadness in this case. But it is what it is, and it's not our place now to start interfering. And it's very, very sad, but we're going to move on from these lines And you never know, miracles do happen. I've seen it many times in the bush where you think it's all over and these animals make a miraculous recovery. One good fat hippo would do it. So hopefully they find a hippo tonight. A couple of the cubs are looking fine. I mean, that one's looking great. And three of them are looking good. One not good at all. One sort of in between. Okay. And out of the adults, Amber's the only one who's looking really bad. Now, Chanel's wondering, do I think the Nkumas would take down a hippo because they're instinctively seeking fat? I think they'd try to take down a hippo because they instinctively hunt hippo. And they are really good at catching big things. We have seen them on a hippo carcass before at Buffalo's Hook Waterhole. That was a long time ago, though. And see, that lioness is looking... a little bit of stiffness in the one leg, but that to me looks more like an injury possibly from the buffalo hunt than anything else. And that fat, fat belly. No, she doesn't look like she's getting up with any difficulty or even lying down with any difficulty. Isn't that cute? They are still the incredible Nkuhumas to me. And hopefully they're going to be able to fight off the white muscle disease. Now, the animals that do survive will have an incredible, incredible genetic strain that will be resilient to this, or more resilient to this type of thing in the future. Okay, well, let's leave the Nkuhumas sleeping and go see what else we can find. Well, hi, Price. Price is wondering, if the Nkuhuma pride does completely disappear, how long will it take other lions to take over their territory? It's near impossible, but it could be as long as a year. Could be as long as 2 years, it could be as short as 2 months, you never know. And quite often we're not 100% sure what's happening with the lion dynamics outside of the Sabi Sands in the Kruger. We've got a good idea about the Manuleti, but you'd probably find that from a lioness pride it would take quite a lot of time because the Birmingham boys don't seem to be affected and they'll still be in this area. So that will keep nomadic males and stuff like that out. So to be honest, I would be guessing if I knew. As long as it takes, I think, is probably the best answer. The station's leaving the Nkuhuma lying up on Gallagher shortcuts just to the north of the first Shkova if you're coming from Weirted Access. Okay, let's keep moving. Now, we're going to go see what Jamie's up to on foot while I chat to find out what's happening with those wild dogs in the north. Standing by.
Jamie is about to do some serious digging into the ground, and my reasons will become apparent in a moment. I hope he stopped immediately, and I have to confess something. He did actually show me an example a little bit earlier. He stopped immediately next to what I would describe as a relatively nondescript kind of a plant. you know. I mean, it's an interesting looking one, and it's got a sort of a three-lobed leaf, and it's quite rough and prickly and very, very, very distinctive now that I know what to look for. But here is the magic, and the magic lies underneath the surface of the soil, which is why I've got my digging stick, my crude digging stick, because, of course, it's one of the things that sets humans apart from most, if not all, no, most animals, not all animals, our ability to use tools. So here we go. We're digging. And this is what we're after. Like archaeologists on a dig site. Except that's not at all what we're like. Like natural foragers searching for something below the surface of the soil. In this case, a massive tuber. If we do this, apparently, what we should find... No, man, get out of my way. Don't worry, I'm going to put it all back in a moment. What we should find is a secondary, actually a primary tuber. This is a secondary tuber connected apparently by essentially a stem that runs between them. And it's an African bush potato, which is used according to Herbert. And that's why I love doing these bushwalks with Herbie, is there's so much that I don't know about the medicinal uses. There's no way on earth that my knowledge in terms of these sorts of things would ever begin to match his. So there's so much that we can actually learn from Herbert and the local culture and the local beliefs surrounding these particular types of plants. You will have seen these before. And when you would have seen them is when elephants dig them up, put them in their mouths. I've seen them many, many times before. Even they do grow much, much larger than this. They can grow to almost sort of, half a watermelon size, give or take a little bit. So they can grow even larger than this one is. And this one is probably a lot larger than it seems. And these potatoes, essentially. It's not an actual true potato, but it's related to them, or the equivalent. It's a storage unit for these plants. So it's got all of its nutrients, its water. It's very, very water rich, and I can actually feel, and you can actually see how damp the soil is around parts of it. So there's lots of water being stored in this particular, essentially, organ of the plant, which is why it would be incredibly valuable to something like an elephant, or apparently steenbok, particularly in the dry season. Apparently they come through and they dig it up. Oh, the cool thing about them is apparently these African potato plants or bulbs essentially form a part of almost all traditional medicines, or muti as they're known. So basically it's, I'm trying to think of a more Western equivalent or a more Western description. It's like the base of a soup, if that makes any sense. That is, it's used in pretty much all of them, and it depends on what it is that you're trying to treat, what it is you're trying to do, but it's essentially the binding product of the whole muti. And you can boil them up, you can cut them up apparently, especially for you can give them to newborn babies to strengthen them. You can use them combined with Bushman's grape, Bushman grape to create various kinds of blood purification. Whatever it is that you happen to be attempting to treat, this is going to help to form your base. And apparently people from all over South Africa will come up and get these, or harvest these particular tubers. Now the cool thing about them apparently is you can basically take a slice of this plant, and you could take it away and you could plant it and it'll grow. But here's the most, for me anyway, I mean all of that's fascinating, but here's the most fascinating thing for me, is there's a belief that if you take the whole plant, your medicine is not really going to work, but you've got to leave a portion of it behind. And it's basically thought that if you don't do that, the medicine won't work at all. Whereas if you... I thought I heard a grasshopper. Sorry, mid-sentence. So you've got to leave... Let me finish the sentence. You've got to leave a portion of it behind in order for the medicine to work. Where's he gone now, eggs?
He's just by your hand.
By my hand. Where?
Just a bit more to your right.
There! Oh my goodness. How is that for camouflage? Just heard him jump on the leaves. See if he can be ever so gentle. Oh, cool. This is such an awesome example of this, and I don't quite know how I'm going to show you. This amazing grasshopper is obviously clearly, clearly built for living in these sorts of conditions.
Yeah.
Iggy, stand up straight. Apparently we're losing signal. Poor Iggy's not allowed to move. In which case, I'm going to attempt... Oh, I've lost him now. He's somewhere here next to my jacket that I have discarded. I've lost it completely. That's why you should... Ready to show you something amazing. Can you see me? Oh! Okay, unfortunately we seem to be having some signal issues, so I'm going to send you across to Brent and try and find my grasshopper.
Whoa, okay, well it seems like there's some gremlins in these clouds today. And, hopefully Byron gets fixed up quickly, and so does Jamie. So till then, you're stuck with the Veerman Brent, and we are heading towards Karula's Cubs. But I think I might take a little detour, because I don't think they're going anywhere, and just have a little gander to see if Mom's about Treehouse Dam or that area. Maybe we'll find the Queen on the hunt. I think the last time Veerm and I were together with Karula on the hunt, we saw a kill, didn't we, Veerm? Yeah, we saw her take down a little grey diker live. And it is a very special thing to be able to see that. Not very many people come to Africa and get to see a live kill. And we're lucky enough to share it with all of you. Now, of course, we are always keeping our eye out for the first impala lamb of the season or the first woodlands kingfisher. I heard one. I did. A very confused one. Very early this morning, I heard a tick-tick, but I haven't heard it again since. Now, fingers crossed that we're going to find it. Well, either woodlands or... Or the first impala. Now, speaking of impalas, Michael's wondering, is it likely that some of the impala ewes might have stillborn babies or even have aborted already due to the lack of nutrients? And most definitely. So to the north of us, where my parents live, we've had a couple of stillborn impala already and a stillborn wildebeest. So it is a strong possibility. And I haven't seen any yet, but I think there still will be a decent crop of impala babies this year. And I think the thing that the impala babies have to worry about the most is, of course, Queen Karula. So we're just doing a little bit of a long route towards where Hosanna and Shangili are. Just checking if we can possibly find Karula on the hunt. Oh, we've got a friend then. Not really a friend, more of a hanger-oner. Ah, we've got rid of it. There we go. That stick there, that was what was caught under the car. Now, strangely enough, the first time I ever, well, I suppose it's not that strange, seeing where we are, the first time I ever saw Karula was just in here. And that was my first introduction to the Queen. I think I had been here permanently for about 3 days or 4 days before I saw her for the first time. And I've been incredibly lucky since then to spend many, many incredible hours with her. And her offspring, Quarantine, Kunuma, Hosanna, Shongile, Shadow, Tandi, Shivambalan. Now, of course, the Woodlands kingfisher are not the only kingfishers that are going to be arriving. I have seen twice already, but we were off air and they were just like little pink and electric blue bullets disappearing. A couple of pygmy kingfishers. And probably the most uncommon of all the kingfisher species that are arriving at this time of the year is the grey-hooded kingfisher. And I have been checking their nest site. They nested in the Mwachi River last year, but so far no sign around the nest. Oh, yay! I feel like I haven't seen them in ages. Elephants! This is the first elephant herd we've seen in such a long time, or I have. Oh, sorry, little one. There's a Hlambi of Ndlovu on Shabam Road, slowly heading to the east. Wonderful. I wonder which herd this is. Let's have a look. See if we can see any individuals that we recognize. Now, that is so wonderful. Janet was wondering if there were any elephants around recently, and there haven't been. With the rain, it's caused these ellies to spread quite wide and far, so we will get them. But as you can see, they're on the move. Oh, hello, little one. Little girl. And elephants always do cheer me up, so maybe they knew after spending time with the lions. We needed a bit of elephant in our life. Let's just go forward a little bit. Is a mud wallow. Maybe they'll even play. It's a bit chilly today. You never know. Oh, so nice to spend some time with Eddies. Even though they are mobile Eddies. Very short elephant sighting before they disappeared into the thickets. Maybe we can catch them on the other side of the thicket. Right, while we get around, try to catch up with the ellies, it seems like Jamie's found some gremlin-free area. So let's go see what she's up to.
Jamie is currently on the move from just to get ourselves around, and we're going to head straight across in that direction. Whew, you okay there, Eggs? We're just dodging some buffalo, and we're just going to keep going around towards the termite mound, and then once we're there, we will be absolutely fine. I'm just going to make sure, while we're going around the buffalo, that we don't go walking into something else at the same time. So here we go. Oh, it's one of my favourite trees. Oh, goodness. That is not something you want to step into or drive into. That should be a nice surprise, although somebody's made that mistake. Sorry, I'm just double checking, making sure that we're not being casually followed around in a great big circle, which does occasionally happen, especially because when we first saw this particular animal, we couldn't have been more downwind of it if we tried. So of course our scent was blowing straight towards it. And what we're doing now is just moving around so that we're upwind of it essentially, so that our scent is blowing away and that they will decide to leave us alone. Sure. Being watched by the sharpest-eyed antelope in the entire bush. Some antelope, some impala watching us. We're not going to delay, we're just going to keep moving around. Ooh, Egg, sorry, I'm walking you through some nasty stuff here. You know, manage. Let's go this way, but not too far. Sure. Buffalo tracks everywhere. Oh, what a nice... I think we can stop now. I think we're fine. If we need to move, we'll go to that termite mound. Really nice giraffe track. Sorry, just while we're looking at it, I know the light is incredibly difficult. But there's a very, very nice giraffe track imprinted here in the sand. Gives you a really... It's another grasshopper. Really nice idea of just how large giraffe are. Interesting. Completely reluctant to... There he goes. Completely hidden and camouflaged in the sand. Beautiful. There are so many. I was so impressed with the camouflage of that particular one earlier. It looked exactly like a leaf. And I promise you, after we lost signal, it took us a good, I would say, a good 5 minutes to find it again. But all three of us are searching desperately to see if we could figure out exactly where it was. Right, so we'll leave our giraffe track and our very pretty grasshopper. He appears to be peering into a termite mound. What you doing? You're checking for mumbas. We were just having a conversation earlier about black mumbas and the fact, did you know, which I didn't because I have never been in such close proximity to them before, apparently black mumbas are really very smelly. Who knew? I certainly did not. Apparently they attract huge amounts of flies, which is another thing that I had absolutely no idea about. I want to take this home, Eggsy, as an ornament. Don't you think it would make an amazing centerpiece in a garden or something similar? I think it's beautiful. Eggsy can carry it. He's not carrying enough right now. He looks like he could do with an extra load or two. Cool. Cool, says Eggsy. I think he's fully up for the challenge. Now, actually, I wanted to stop a little bit earlier at the hyena den on Philemon's cutline, but unfortunately that was when we realised we were being slowly but surely followed by an animal, and so we're going to continue on around it. But I would have loved to have stopped there just to show you the ins and outs of an old hyena den. It's the best we can get at this point now that our hyenas have completely abandoned us. Whew. Okay, maybe the coat was a bit excessive. It's definitely excessive. So while we make sure that we're fully and 100% in the clear, let's go back over to Brent to get an update from his side.
Oh, unfortunately, those alleys went deeper into the block, but it did bode well for the rest of the safari, having a nice little herd of alleys around. Maybe they'll pop out again a little later. I've gone into a very thick area to the west of Treehouse Dam, but I'm nearly where the Prince and Princess of Juma are, or were. Hopefully Karula hasn't popped in while we've been with the Ellies and moved them off. I'm fingers crossed not. And I'm hoping Krula went hunting that way, to the north, not to the south. And just to let you know, Byron and Jandre with Wendy are back at camp, having a little zhuzh to try and get those signal issues sorted, so hopefully they'll be out shortly. Okay, let's see where these leopards are. I know where they were, as we found them on foot. Now, Apparently a couple of hundred meters further to the west. So that's around here somewhere, maybe. Matthew's been watching and listening, because on a previous show, Matthew said he heard you can differentiate leopard gender from their footprints, and he's wondering how. Well, Matthew, it's very easy. It's size. So you'll probably find that young Hosanna's tracks are almost, if not bigger than his mother's already at 9 months. So it's all about size, and that's how we tell it. A male leopard's tracks are probably 50% larger than a female's, and a young male's obviously somewhere in between. Now, of course, you do get exceptions to that rule, and I've seen one particular female I used to see a long time ago down to the south called the Sunset Bend female. She had massive tracks for a female leopard. Always confused, or it did confuse a lot of people. Ah, I see off-roading tracks, so I'm assuming that this is where the royal family were hiding. Well, not all of them, but some of them. Of course, they're choosing some very thick bush. Ah, I see one. It looks like Chongqing. Yes. Now, there's little Chongqing. Where is naughty Hosanna? Oh, sorry about that. There's a. That definitely looks like little Chongqing. Well, let's get a bit closer. Big Safari Live welcome to UK2K, who's a brand new viewer. It's wonderful to have you on the back of the world's biggest safari vehicle. And UK2K would like to know, how old are these beautiful little leopards? Oh, look at that view, isn't that stunning? Now, they are just under 10 months old now. They'll be 10 months old on the 2nd of December. There is little Chongqing. Now, if we fall, I wonder where her brother is. I'm sure he's around here, and where she's looking is probably where he is. Making sure he doesn't launch a sneak attack on her, which we have seen him do before while she's been snoozing. So it's not uncommon for female leopards to leave their babies in an area like this. There's lots of good spots to hide, trees to climb in case any other predators were to come along here. And she's off in search of dinner. Now, there are two cubs in this litter, and Nicole in Canada is wondering, how many cubs can a leopard have? The most I've ever heard of in the wild is four. Two or one are normal, three is abnormal. So I'd say two is probably the norm. And now, it's very unusual in most cases for a female leopard to be able to raise two cubs to independence. But our Queen Karula seems to do it all the time. She is such a fantastic mother. Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard here on Juma. Let's move a little bit further forward. Let's see if we can see the naughty Hosanna and what he's up to. Where are you hiding, mister? Now, Chongqing keeps looking in this area here, so he could be anywhere here. Vierma's nose is working very well. I can smell waterbuck. Now, waterbuck quite often will secrete an oily substance from a gland on their neck, and it's one of the few antelope species you can smell quite clearly, especially on a day like today. Let's just turn around. No sign of him yet, but I'm quite sure he's watching us as we try to find him. Another new viewer, welcome, Gets By. And Gets By would like to know, do you see these leopards often? We do. These are the leopards we probably see the most often. And Karula is the female who holds territory over the majority of Juma. And she has successfully raised many litters of cubs here. Let's try get us maybe a bit higher. What do you think, Vim, up here? Let's see, I just want to check if he wasn't lying over there. Can't see him. And there we go. How's that, Vim? Yes, so we do see these leopards quite regularly. They do. Her territory does extend outside of our traverse area, so she does spend some time outside of where we can see her, but. When she is around, she is definitely one of our best creatures to see. And this particular litter is quite special for me. Now, this litter was born nearly 10 months ago. And I happened to be the first to see them when they were the tiniest little sausages. And they were just the tiniest little things. I saw them within about 6 or 7 hours of them being born, which is extremely rare. So very, very, very excited, and I'm very, very much attached to these two, and I can't wait. And I'm really hoping that Shongile in particular becomes a resident leopard on Juma when she becomes independent. Now, female leopards will often give up part of their core territory to their daughters, so their daughters have a better, easier start in life, and they don't have to fight another female for territory. The males will eventually disperse to stop them mating with their sisters and cousins and mothers as they get older, and they normally end up quite far from their natal territory. Now, remember, if you are new and you want to ask questions, it's very easy. Use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can pop us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. Now, I think I'm going to sit tight here, and I'm going to hope Karula is going to come back and fetch them and possibly take them off to another meal. Oh, when I said meal, her ears picked up. There we go. Now, good news. Byron is back out, so let's go see what his plans are for the rest of the afternoon.
I am back finally. Myself and Jandre hopefully have fixed the problem. Well, I didn't. The wizards and magicians back at the DRC fixed it, I think. So hopefully we don't have any more problems, everyone. I'm heading back towards the Nkuhuma Pride that Brent had earlier, hoping that they're still around and maybe we get some movement and activity out of them. And just see what they are up to. I haven't seen them since this terrible disease, or the disease we think that's hit them. And so it would be interesting to see. And I mean, 2 weeks ago they were fine, absolutely nothing wrong. So it is very sad news, but it is nature. So we'll see what they're up to. Yeah, they are. They're just up ahead of us, everyone. Fantastic. Right here in the road. Wow, we're going to get a lovely view, actually, from down here. Just going to park here. There's another vehicle up at the top there, everyone. Oh, there we go. cubs and the females. Not sure if there was a male here. Brent did say he saw a male earlier, so I'm sure that he is somewhere around here. Now, well, what a fantastic afternoon so far for everyone. Firstly, the little leopards, and now the pride of lions. All the pride of lions have been around. Brent found them quite early on in drive, which is great. So it's been a big cat Saturday for us, which is wonderful. Such a lovely, cool afternoon, and that's why we're so fortunate. I think there's the male at the back. I can you see him. There he goes. That female turned over. You can see the mane. There he is, one of the Birmingham males. And as I was saying, with it being such a lovely, cool afternoon, it's great because a lot of these animals are out in the open. We know that generally lions, when it is hot, they prefer to lie in the shade and rest. But it is overcast, but it's so nice to have weather like this for a change out in the bush, especially in summer. And just before we lost you earlier, while our signal died on us, we did manage to find that red-chested cuckoo. Unfortunately, it flew away just before we could show you, which was nice. I know Jandre actually wanted to see one. He said he hadn't seen one yet this season. And I can hear a black cuckoo calling too in the distance. Beautiful, beautiful call from these cuckoos. So nice having them back now in the summer. I know Brent was talking to you earlier about some of the kingfishers and that have returned for the summer. And all these cuckoos, all these migratory birds which have returned, which is wonderful. So it's nice to hear them. And just sitting around enjoying sightings like this with these lions so close to us resting, you can still appreciate all the bird life around, which is fantastic. I'm hoping that Christine is watching on her birthday and enjoying it and hopefully saw the leopards and the lions. Christine, I'm not sure. I know you said you had some interesting coffee or hot chocolate there earlier with some Amarula. And those of you who've been on safari with us before or been out there, you know that Amarula in a coffee, a little bit of liqueur, but it's delicious. And it is very tasty and keeps you warm in the winter especially. So I hope you're enjoying your special coffee or hot chocolate while watching the lions and that with us. All right, I'm going to spend some time with these lions. Let's sit here, just see what they get up to. While I do that, Jamie's got an interesting nest she'd like to show you.
We are currently standing next to a community spider's nest. I say standing next to, poor Iggy is actually positively planted by antenna into the tree that is holding the community spider's web, which is, of course, a buffalo thorn. But I've just learned, and I think this afternoon has kind of turned into me translating Herbie's amazing information, because I've just learned something new that I never knew about these community spider nests. And we've spoken about these things many, many times before, which is, it's unusual for a spider to live in a community. They're not like termites, they're not like ants for the most part. If a spider interacts with another spider, it's either to mate or to eat them, or in some cases both, one after the other, you guess the order. Now this community spider's nest is really truly unique. Obviously they've got their catchment webs, this isn't an active one by the way, so I'm not disturbing them in any way, there's no spiders home at present. So this is the catchment nest, or catchment web, very, very, very sticky material, and basically what happens of course is that things like a normal spider, something like, for example, this hapless bug, get trapped in the stickiness of the web, and then the hunting parties from the community nest itself will come in and bring the food, suck out as much juice as they can, because you can see this is just the exoskeleton, and then take food back for the rest of the spiders. So a very interesting social structure and very rare. And sometimes in spider life, sometimes what you can do is if you tap the web gently, you can actually get them to all come scurrying out. But as I said, it's not active at all. There's no spiders home. Here's the amazing part that Herbie's just told me. So there's a traditional belief that you can use this as a way to treat any kind of mental disorder. Obviously, it's very difficult for us to explain or to understand, but essentially, the understanding is, or the belief is, that the spiders catch all kinds of things in their web, and they suck out the juices of these things and they turn it into the nest itself. So essentially this community nest spider's web is basically made up of so many different parts. And the idea is that it will help to pull together that person's mind or that person's memories or something along those lines. So what you do apparently is it's burned in a way and then obviously created into presumably some kind of a potion. Occasionally, combined with hyena scat, which is actually relatively gross because hyena scat is really not the most pleasant of things. But again, because hyenas eat everything. So in a way, they're part of many, many different things. And it makes you wonder, you have to think how it makes sense in a way. The logic is there. You just have to wonder how it came to be and what led to the evolution. Ow. I got so distracted by the story, I pricked myself on the buffalo thorn. You have to wonder about what it was that led to that experimentation. And of course, a lot of scientific advances, a lot of scientific production of medicine have come from experimenting and using local beliefs. So aspirin, willow bark, being the example that I use very often, it's derived from the bark of a willow tree. There's no reason why certain things might not help. This one, okay, I'm struggling to find a pup. There might be medicinal properties within the web itself, but isn't that fascinating? So there you go, a really, truly interesting story. Second cool part of the story that Herbie told me, he used to use it as a flycatcher, as a homemade flycatcher. So they'd take an old nest like this one, an abandoned nest like this one. When they were milking the cows, they'd cut this web open, spread it out, and use it as a flycatcher. So where the flies were attracted to the milk, they'd go and use it as a resting place, they'd sit on it, and they'd get trapped. Homemade fly trap, it's like fly tape, just natural. How cool is that? What a fascinating way of doing things. So there you go. I have learned at least two new things about the community spider's nest that I have seen time and time and time again on walk. I've spoken about on walk, I've spoken about on drive. This was a new lesson for me today. So we've arrived at Treehouse Dam, and we're not going to explore too much further. There's lots of fresh buffalo tracks, and there's lots of relatively upset buffaloes around at the moment, very stressed out after the drought. However, you're right there, Eggsy. For those of you who are new to this whole, let me just, Eggsy, do you mind being on camera for a second? I'm not very good with it, though. Sorry, excuse that, I'm not a camera woman. Just to give those of you who are new to these live drives an idea, that is what Eggsy is carrying on his back, a large backpack. Don't ask me how it works, because I don't know. How much does it weigh, Eggs?
Enough.
Enough.
Yeah.
It weighs enough. I'm so good at this. I suppose I should do that, shouldn't I? Okay, here you go.
I can't present.
You can't present? No. Well, I can't do camera, so let's not swap our roles around. So we're gonna go ducking around Treehouse Dam and start to move back towards home before it gets dark. We've still got a while, but we've got to make sure we're not too far from home. So while we do that, let's head back across to Byron and the incredible Nkuhumas.
We've just changed positions, everyone. We're still sitting with the Nkuhuma pride. There's one little cub suckling from the mother over there. They seem very, very relaxed at the moment. Not too much movement from them. It's incredible. I always mention this to my guests when we are out on safari and we do come across these animals, or pride of lions, for example, and they resting and sleeping like they are now, and you know, it looks like they're completely fast asleep, but it's amazing how these animals would react to any movement and any unnatural sound. If we had to step off the vehicle. Now, they are used to the vehicle somewhat because of the time that we spent tracking and following and finding these animals, spending time with them. They do get somewhat habituated to the vehicles because they know there's no threat or danger. However, if we had to just get off this vehicle for any reason, which you wouldn't, but if you did have to or come walking down the road, these lions would be up in a flash. And it's because they are incredibly aware and incredibly alert of what's going on around them. Rita, you would like a quick cub count. Let me just have a look. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I think. I think there are 5 here. Is that one on the other side? Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that I can see, Rita. 5 little cubs. This one's resting very, very comfortably there. Copy that. There are 2 here at the moment. You can make your way as a 3rd. Just updating one of the other vehicles coming to see the lions with us. So wonderful that that there are, you know, people on safari around here in this area, and they also get to see all these animals while we do. Sure. That female's belly looks very big. I wonder if they fed yesterday. I actually don't know. Yeah. Jandre, do you know? No, they did. Okay, so. Buffalo, another buffalo. Wow, no, another 2 buffalo. So, you know, everyone, for the past 3 weeks now, 3 weeks, almost a month, these lions have been very successful in hunting the buffalo. But as we've seen, the buffalo are not in good condition. And it's because of that bad drought that we had. I think they'll start doing a lot better now because there's a lot of grass, green grass, that's come up over the last 2 weeks. But it's going to take a bit of time. But the buffalo were really, really struggling. They weren't as strong and powerful as they usually are. So the lions were finding it easy to hunt them. And that is why I think, one of the reasons why that they were killing buffalo. The other reason is that there were so many around. For some reason, we had herds coming through this area quite regularly or daily, and these lions would find the buffalo and then separate one or two and usually manage to kill one, if not more, on a daily basis, which is very, very interesting. But it's amazing how, again, very opportunistic. Even if they're not that hungry, if there's food around, they'll still hunt. And that's exactly what was going on. These buffalo were in the area, easy targets, and these lions are able to hunt them very successfully. But it appears, and those of you who heard Jamie's explanation or in theory earlier, it appears as if it's been to the detriment of these cubs and these lions, which is a possibility. I don't know, very, very interesting situation at the moment with these lions, and it's sad, and we don't always know the answers. Again, I do think it's occasionally just nature's way of keeping a balance, even though it is very, very sad to see. what I'm going to do. Just reposition slightly. There's another vehicle here and see if they can't get a better view. So I'm just going to move forward quickly. Let's make sure everybody gets a good view. There we go. So they can move if they want to. I'm not parked on a slope. Yeah, it's just the five cubs that I can see. I'm just double checking myself to make sure. And that's interesting. So some of our new viewers, if you've just tuned in and are watching this pride, the prominent pride in this area, and they've been around for quite a few years. I think since 2008. Obviously, different females taking over as the older females die from old age. But they have been very successful, and they've, especially the last month, and I think it's been about 60-odd days, I think, with the lions being seen every day, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know what the count is. It was about 57 or 58 while I was here, so it's possibly more now. But I don't know if there was a break while I was away. Not so every day, so that's been incredible. So this is the central part of their territory, and they've been very happy here because they've been able to hunt, and it's been a good area for them. And there were 8 cubs originally, but it appears as if 3 have died from this disease, which is very sad, which has hit them suddenly. And 2 weeks ago they were looking healthy, there was nothing wrong. All of a sudden, it appears as if they've picked up some disease, which is very, very sad. But again, it is sometimes nature's way of keeping a balance, even though it is hard for us to see. And quite sad, because they did look like they were doing very well. And it's been a very hard season for these lions. The mange was a big issue for a long time. Not just this pride, but another pride, the Styx pride in the south. And also battled with mange and lost a few cubs, and then this pride appeared to have picked it up. And I think they may have got it from the males, perhaps. And now with this white muscle disease. That big male just off to the side, still lying down there. Now these males, a few of them, so this male comes from a coalition of 4 big males, and he was, a few of them were trying to mate with some of the females from the pride, so who knows, perhaps in a few weeks we may have some new little cubs around. I'm not sure. Depends if the mating was successful or not. Look at him, it's just lying down. That's wonderful. Alright, are we going to sit here for a little bit longer? Just see if they do decide to get up and move around. But while we do that, let's head back to Jamie before she heads back to camp. It is getting a bit darker now. And just see what she's up to.
So remember the goblet of the bushwalk, or the goblet of the Marula, depending on which title you feel suits it best. Well, Herbert has just taught me the most fascinating thing that I would love to be able to share with you. And it all comes back to the sort of the connection, because this afternoon's walk has been very much about traditional medicine and traditional approaches to various problems in life. So essentially what we have here, just to break it down, we have some water that I will show you in a moment, but I'm not going to ask Eggsy to contort in order to show it to you because he might fall into it. We have the goblet of the bushwalk. We have a stick of a bushveld gardenia. which is a tree that at the moment the elephants have been very, very interested in. But Herbie has managed to find one that he's carved into a very, and I think that's one of the big reasons why, one of the reasons gardenias use, he's carved into a very specific shape. Have a look at the shape, because it's important to the whole story, essentially. Just in terms of the four prongs, one upwards and three outwards. And then we've got some shavings of the gardenia bark as well. Now, here's the deal. Here's how it all works. Now, Herbie's done some digging, much like an elephant would do around a treehouse dam. And he has managed to get some water for us, which I'm going to bend down to now and try not to fall into. Can you imagine if I slipped in? It would be utterly hilarious. So we've got lots and lots of water here. This is exactly what the elephants do when they're seeking out fresh water. Even though there's water in the dam, they much prefer to drink from water that they have dug up, and that's slightly cleaner than the water that's part of the dam that the buffalo have been, you know, doing their thing in. So here you go. This is how it all works. Now we've taken this water. And apparently, now I can't perform the whole thing for you, because it actually takes a few days, apparently. So what you do is you take the shavings of this gardenia, you pop it in here, and you leave that for about a day or two. I don't think I'm going to carry it all the way back home. We're going to have to dig it in here. I'll make a plan with it in a moment. After a day or two, the trainees who are training to become a sangoma, what will happen is they'll come back. This will be stirred up into what essentially becomes a white foaming, frothing substance. And from there, part of the ritual is that the trainees will go down on their knees as a sign of respect. So essentially, I'm doing this right, Herbert, exactly like this, with their hands behind their back, again as a sign of respect, and they'll lean forward and they will eat the foam. Now, one of the most important reasons behind this ritual, and one of the most important reasons behind the shape of this, is because this whole ritual, from what I understand, is about bringing the ancestors of the trainees into connection with the trainer and the ancestor of the trainer, the person who is training them to become a sangoma, so that they will learn and learn to divine, have the dreams from the ancestors in a much quicker way. So it's basically essentially bringing together all parts of that belief. So this is the central stick, is all about the trainer. And the outside ones, essentially the spiral around it, is about connecting the souls of the ancestors of the trainees. Now, how's that for an incredible story? I had no idea that this was the case, but it's a fascinating use, and I don't think I will ever, ever look at a bushveld gardenia in exactly the same way ever again. So how fascinating is that? Now I've got to figure out, Herbie, is something going to come and steal this if I dig it in here? Maybe. Maybe not. Let's put it somewhere. Now, obviously, the foam doesn't become toxic. Well, I don't know. Does it make them hallucinate or anything like that? The foam? No. It's just a foam. I feel like the elephants might come and dig this up. But let's try. Let's see in a day or so if we can come back, if this survives, if it doesn't evaporate. Normally, we'd go and find a shady spot for it. But let's see if the goblet of the bushwalk survives, and that we can come back in a day or so and have a look at the foamy substance that makes. How cool is that? Such a fascinating, fascinating insight into the way that this works in terms of uses for trees. For me, a gardenia has always been a gardenia. And just that. Just a gardenia. Now, forever after, when I see it, it will mean so much more. I've got to take the gardenia with me. Otherwise, it wouldn't work, presumably. So how cool is that? Totally a fascinating, fascinating insight into the way in which the training is done. And of course, this morning, they were hearing... I keep hearing music as well now, but I don't know if I'm imagining things. There's drums coming. Is that the same drums, or is just somebody having a party? I think it's somebody just having a party. But this morning there were drum beats coming from the local community outside of the reserve that we're in. And apparently it's training, sangoma training. Really, really, truly fascinating. And something that I'm going to have to learn a little bit more about, I think, in the future. Right, we better start heading for home, because the cloud cover is thickening, and therefore our light is disappearing far faster than it might otherwise. I think we're going to start striking out for home. Make sure that we are within a relatively close distance once it does start to get dark. A fascinating bushwalk this has been. And as wonderful as it is to focus in on the little things, and we have a little bit with grasshoppers and so on, but as wonderful as it is to focus on the little things and to walk some of the bigger things, it's equally fascinating to gain insight into a completely different culture, but one that is in its own, well, definitely far more connected to this area than perhaps we might be. And Jen, in Minnesota, you say you have loved all of these lessons today. Jen, so have I. And we have the wonderful Herbie to thank for that. It's been an absolutely magical afternoon. Thank you, Herbie. It's been very, really, truly fascinating. So we're going to continue striking out back towards home. Let's go back to Byron and his lions.
So... lions, I think one or two have rolled over, and that's about it. They're still very need to go off and hunt. They'll definitely start moving later this evening. They're just still conserving the energy, and I think also, unfortunately, with that disease that they've got at the moment, I think it probably is quite draining for a lot of these animals. And they're not as active as they usually would be if they are fit and healthy. It's funny, they don't look in bad condition, though. If you had to just see this pride of lions, you'd think they look pretty good. But apparently it's when they get up and start moving around and walking that you see a problem. Become a bit quiet in the bush. One or two birds still calling, but not as many as earlier. Isn't that just so cute? Lying on, or just about on, the tail of the mother. You know, the cubs get very playful with the tails of the females, often try and bite them and pull them. You know, often I think to myself, because, you know, we're very fortunate that we get to follow and find animals on a daily basis, those of us who do work in the bush regularly, and we need to occasionally just remind ourselves how lucky we are and how fortunate we are to be able to get so close to these wild animals and view them. And the only reason at the end of the day is because they allow us to. If these lions didn't want to be seen, or if they weren't comfortable with us, we wouldn't see them. Same with those leopards that we saw earlier and that Brent has been with. If they and did not want to be seen, I guarantee you will not see them. These animals are incredibly elusive. So when we do see them like this out in the open, it is such a wonderful experience to be able to sit with wild lions. I think it reminds me actually of a quote. I hope I get this right. I think it was by Karen Blixen. She was an author, and I think she wrote I Dream of Africa. And in the book, I think she says, it is only when you have lived amongst lions that you truly feel alive. She lived, I think, up in East Africa, and obviously got to see many lions, and such a just a lovely little quote about the lions. And when you hear them calling in the evening, there's actually nothing better. It is a wonderful, wonderful sound, and always wonderful to have these massive predators around, even though we feel very comfortable with them at the moment. Speaking of big predators, Brent is still with those little cubs. Let's go back to him and see what they're up to.
Well, young Hosanna came to join the party. He didn't sneak up too much on his sister this time and jump on her like I've seen him do in the past. But he has arrived, and no sign of Mom. And with this cloud cover, it is getting dark very quickly. I'm just going to move a bit forward. Maybe we can get a better view of the little prince. Oh, there we go. There's a gap. And a little bit more. There we go. Hello, Mr. Hosanna. What have you been doing? Oh, look at that. Turning into a very, very beautiful young male leopard. Sort of, not quite, but almost sort of shrugging off his cuteness, and he's, as he grows bigger and bigger, by no means does he become less magnificent, but he is losing some of those cubby features, not all of them just yet. Remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you have any queries about these incredible cats. He's almost got that, oh, I'm so bored, no one wants to play with me look on his face. Watching intently. And so you can see his eyes moving. I wonder what he's pondering. I think he's pondering, what's Mom going to bring home for dinner? Will it be a lovely impala shank? Will it be warthog ribs? Will it be a Steenbok rump? His eyelids getting heavy. Now let's hope Karula is successful in her hunting. Successful on Juma, and hopefully we'll be able to find her tomorrow. Tomasek, he doesn't trust you, Vim, keeping one eye on all the time. Well, the Priss Trip, who's another new viewer, welcome. And the Priss Trip is wondering, how is it that they don't attack us? Well, firstly, they're very young, 10 months old. So they would generally flee rather than attack if they felt threatened. And they've grown up with us around them. And if you drive carefully and respectfully around animals, they don't have an instinctive response to the vehicles. The vehicle's only been around for just over 100 years. Now, if I was to get out of the car and they saw the bipedal figure of man, who's been the dominant diurnal predator for man, they would run away. Or a female this close, she might attack if it was an adult female, but it's unlikely. Most animals do not want to attack you. They don't want to get any injuries without, for no reason. The only time that really changes is with lions, and only really after dark, where we fall within a lion's natural prey spectrum. With leopards and human beings, only small or children really would fall within a leopard's sort of normal prey spectrum. An adult human is a bit too big. Not to say they're not capable of taking humans, and of course there's been many recorded cases of man-eaters in the past, but generally those are in very specific circumstances, and an old animal or an injured animal, where it's not able to hunt its natural prey, it turns to man-eating out of sheer desperation. Or it can even be learnt behaviour. Now, some of the more famous man-eating big cats are from India, and leopards and tigers, but leopards in particular, I'm going to have to go find its name. There was a leopard that was credited, a male leopard, with eating 825 people. I think it was probably more than one leopard, but that was the leopard that took the blame. Now, at that point, if I remember my Indian history correctly, there was an outbreak of cholera. And in the Hindu religion, normally corpses are cremated, but that was during a large pilgrimage, and most of the people on that pilgrimage were very ill, too ill to cremate the dead along the way. So what was done often was just a single coal, lit coal from a fire, was placed in the deceased's mouth. And what happened is that tigers and leopards in that area started scavenging off those human remains that were left on the side of the road during the pilgrimage. And it actually turned into a man-eating epidemic after that, because they sort of learnt. And you probably find also that they got hold of people who were very ill, so not very well, before they died. And so that man-eating became a very learnt behaviour. And there was quite a famous, I think he was a colonel in the British Army, and a guy by the name of Jim Corbet. He's probably one of the most famous man-eater hunters of all time, and he's hunted many man-eating tigers and leopards in India, and I think it was probably 19th century into the 20th century. Well, I'm a bit rusty. I'll have to check up on my tiger and leopard man-eating history. Now, of course, it's one of those things that really fascinates people, an animal that has the capability of hunting and attacking a human. And if we look at folklore and stories, and the big cats hold a very special place in a lot of that folklore. Yes, talking about you, mister. You're a big cat. Not quite yet, but you will be. Now, Michael's wondering about Hosanna's name, which means little prince or little chief. And I think Michael's wondering whether it'll be changed to Horsey, which is chief or prince, when he's older. Probably not, Michael. I think it'll probably stay as Hosanna. Look at that. He hasn't closed that eye. He's just been keeping an eye. I think he's keeping an eye on VM. Of course, I'm only joking. He's just generally keeping an eye on everything that's around. Probably not too tired, probably been sleeping most of the day, and just waiting patiently for Mom to return. Now, Mom can leave them for 2 to 3 days in a spot like this, if she's not successful in hunting. Shongile, on the other hand, is embracing nap time, really embracing nap time at the moment, flat on her back. Head popped up. What did you hear? Head down and head down. No, it is getting quite dark, and we're not going to stay with these cubs without Mom after dark. And we might meander on, see what else is out and about in this African wonderland we call home. And fingers crossed that Mom manages to catch them some dinner on Juma tonight. Okay, well, we leave these incredible leopard cubs to go see what else is out and about. Let's go back to Byron with some lion cubs.
So we're just still sitting with the lions, everyone. They just two little cubs stood up and are suckling at the moment from the one lioness. Look at this female. Keeping a close eye on the vehicle just behind us.
Oh, well, it seems like Byron found a gremlin. I'm at an awkward angle as I'm reversing out of the bed, but welcome back. Always great to have you with us. Bye, leopards. Who knows, maybe we'll find Mom on her way back here. Oof. Where have all these gremlins crept out of? I have to get Mr. Voz with a big gremlin stick out there. Okay, so while we go see what else we can find, it is getting to that time of the day, as I mentioned, where it becomes unsafe to be on foot because the lions become the dominant predator and we no longer are. So let's go see Jamie so she can bid you adieu.
I don't know whether you caught the end bit of my dance. Sorry? No, we're not going far. We have also gone live. So that would be our rescue team, because I did something naughty and we kept walking a little bit too long and it didn't quite get to the point where we could have made it home before dark, which is a relatively silly thing to do, and I have done in the past. Luckily, Alex has come to our rescue and decided to rejoin us. I'm not going to walk too much further up the road because I feel as though Alex and Herbie are getting quite anxious there in the Mahindra. So obviously you get to this time of day where I can't see as well. It's still light, and it's probably still light enough to walk, but we've just walked into a herd of elephants that took us completely by surprise, and I can't see shapes properly. You start to lose, this time of day, this sort of dusk time of day, you start to lose your depth perception and your ability to distinguish between objects. We are just not built to be nocturnal creatures, and the animals of the bush know it. So I would prefer not to stumble over a buffalo or a lion or anything along those lines, and so we called in the rescue brigade that are standing waiting patiently for us to rejoin them. So, I think we're going to start heading back in their direction. We were pretending to walk, hence that was the little dance that we did. We were pretending to walk up the hill and not down it, but apparently Byron's lost signal, so you can accompany me as we walk back towards the car, otherwise the car is to follow us up to protect us, and so on. So I hope you enjoyed the masterclass of traditional beliefs that essentially Herbie took for us. Rebecca, what's happening? Rebecca lost the ability to speak there. So, on behalf of all of us at Safari Live, thank you so much for joining us, for sending through your questions and your comments. Thank you to Eggsy for all of his wonderful camera work. We're going to get onto our ride home in a moment. Until we see you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
So, I think we just lost all of you. I think we're going to continue our drive. we can find perhaps some interesting nocturnal animals. Who knows? First night drive back for me after a little break. So let's see how my spotting skills are. You know, it's always difficult to multitask, I say. Spotting the spotlight and talking to everyone and the voices in my head from Final Control. But lovely to see the lions, though, even though, you know, there's a bit of distress amongst them at the moment, but still wonderful to get to spend some time with them and show them to you. Let's see if we can get out of here quickly. Try to leave the tree behind, rather. Here we go. I'm just going to go around them. I don't want to disturb them, so I'll just take this little track around them. Don't want to drive too close to them. You know, even though they are relaxed with the vehicles close to them, we just still don't want to drive right up to them. Occasionally, you'll have lions coming very close and walk right past the vehicles, but I think it's a case of if they approach you, they are comfortable, but if you drive straight up to them, they definitely move away. They are still a little bit nervous of the vehicles, and there's still something very big which they don't really know much about, but they do recognize the sound of the vehicles and the smells. But if you had to drive right up to them, you would disturb them and cause them to move, which we don't want to do. Anyway, time for the spotlight. Almost. What is that? Is there a bird in the tree there? Am I seeing things? It looks like a vulture. Let's see, is it a little hooded vulture, everybody. Look at that. That's a nice little surprise. I'm not sure where that carcass was, if it was anywhere near. Yeah, it looks like it, but also perhaps because these lions have been lying around out in the open. There are one or two other vultures in the trees around, not far from here. So perhaps that carcass was around here and these vultures. And Jandre is nodding, so their carcass was close by, and that's why these vultures are in the area. But it's been a very cool day, so probably not a lot of flying from these vultures. You know, they use the hot thermals to be able to rise up and fly around looking for food. So I think at the moment, and especially now, they'll roost up in the trees, and here's some more off to the right. They'll roost up in the trees, rest there for the night. So they'll just rest there. And Twit Jumper, you were just saying thank you for showing you the shikra earlier. A new bird on your list. Wonderful. I'm so glad that it was a new bird for you. It's always wonderful to try get the bird lists up a little bit. It's a first for me in this area. I haven't seen a shikra here yet or on Safari Live yet. So nice to see that. Alright, so the usual, I'm going to try my best to find some little scorpions or chameleons, maybe a little owl, who knows. I was lucky on the last drive I did, just before I went away, found a little pearl spotted owl, which was great, but I haven't heard any owls calling just yet, perhaps a bit later. And let's see what else we can find. And who knows, maybe some other little nocturnal animals. And a question from Stephanie, and I think it's possibly the lifespan of a vulture, what the lifespan of a vulture is. Stephanie, I'm not entirely sure. I'm trying to think now. I actually don't know. I'd have to double check for you, Stephanie. I don't know what the lifespan of a vulture is. I would guess maybe 10 to 15 years, somewhere around there, but I have no idea. I'll have to double check. I'm not sure if the apps or anything like that do tell us. Well, if any of our viewers are able to find out and let us know, that would be interesting. What the lifespan of a vulture is. Levette would like to know what my favorite bird is, and I do enjoy birding in general. It's always wonderful to try and see new species and find little birds out there, especially when you hear them calling and to identify them by the call and then find them. My favorite bird, I think, you know, I'd have to say a Marshall Eagle. Beautiful, beautiful big eagle that we get in this area. And I do just love seeing them. What else? There are a lot of little birds I like. There's some beautiful little colored, beautifully colored birds. We've got the bee eaters, which come back for the summer. The kingfishers are beautiful to see. I love, there's a little bird called the black-crowned shagra. And that black-crowned shagra has got a beautiful call. They usually fly in the thickets, very low down, and they're not always easy to see. But they've got this beautiful melodious call. It sounds almost... Oh, let me see if I can do it. It's a... that's not very good. It's something similar to that. But a beautiful, beautiful call, and I love hearing them in the... In the bush, and while we're out here, I'm gonna start looking for all these little nocturnal creatures. While I do that, let's head over to Brent and see what he's up to and if he's got anything to show you.
Well, we're also looking for nocturnal creatures, but we are including all the ones Byron mentioned, and maybe, who knows, the Queen of Juma, she might be about. I'd love to actually catch up with some hyenas, although that likelihood is very slim. I'm gonna keep looking for chameleons. It's that sort of half light now that its spotlight doesn't really work. Oh, I might go past one of my favorite bush baby dens as well. So the side light's actually the trick to finding. Oh, what have I found? It's not alive, but I have been seeing it relatively often. But the problem is I've been so busy with big cats that I haven't been able to go have a proper look at it. Yay! Oh, that is delicious. Vim, you want to smell? That is possibly, it is one of the nicest smelling things in the African bush. Bliss. Now, who can tell me what it is? I've actually transplanted this before, and it grows as a creeper up the whole wall of my old room at Londolozi, and I'm definitely thinking I'm going to have to transplant some to our new house, get it growing on the walls there, because the smell is literally intoxicating. Better than any of the most expensive perfumes. So if you know what it is, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. And to give you another hint, it's also the name of a Disney princess. Aha, let's continue. So nice. I'm feeling so wonderful after that. I'm cleansing the nasal passages. There's some more growing up there. It'll probably be a bit of a better one to show you than that little one I spotted there. Let's get the light on it. So there's two different types. One grows as a bush or a tree, and the other grows as a creeper. Oh, this is the one that grows as a creeper. Oh, delicious. Especially at this time of the day, if you're in the right area and there's a little bit of a breeze, which we don't have today, and the air is permeated with that smell. It just soaks up everything. It's wonderful. I think James and Steph, who have been spending a bit of time at that rotting buffalo carcass at Buffalo's Hook, could do well with collecting some of those flowers to put up their nose when they're close by. Oh dear, it's falling off. Sorry about that. There we go, that looks better. So I'm gonna head up towards as I said, one of my favorite bush baby dens. Slowly, slowly. Oh, what have we found here? Oh, we found another. Oh, Eddie's. We're not going to put lights on. I'm pretty sure this is probably the same herd we saw earlier. They've just moved through those thickets and popped out on the other side. I know it is a bit dark, but we're not going to put lights on them. Sometimes they get a little upset. Yes, there's the same little female calf. And sometimes Eddies don't like light, so as I said, we're not going to put any lights on them. Oh, so cute. Bye, Eddies. We're still in that sort of half light, but maybe I might catch a bush baby in my spotlight. You never know. Well, well done to Brenda, Paula and Heidi and many, many others. You were spot on. It is indeed Jasmine, wild Jasmine. Rebecca seems to think that my Disney princess comment gave it away. But I think a lot of you guys have been... Oh, I thought it was a Scops owl for a second. It's not. It's a stump. You guys have been watching and I know you've seen that Jasmine many, many times in the wet season. It is such a wonderful smell. I almost wish there was a way that we could transport the smell of the jasmine through the camera. As much as I wish there was no way to transport the smell of a rotting buffalo carcass through the camera. And you can start hearing the insect life come alive now. And who knows, we might find some scorpions. Speaking of night lists, I nearly did forget to mention that I saw my first Mozambique spitting cobra last night on our way home from the DRC. A little one, a baby spitting cobra. And also we had our first snake visitor to the DRC, which is a beautiful little snake, but I'll pop a video of that snake up after drive so you guys who want to have a look. It's called an East African shovel nose, or shovel snout, sorry. But speaking of night lists, let's see how Byron's faring with his.
Not too good just yet, Brent. We're still looking in search for anything interesting. Sure, it's always difficult this time of the evening. It's tricky with the light because it's not quite dark enough for the spotlight to be used correctly, and it's not light enough for us to be able to spot properly. So it's a bit difficult, but it's getting darker, which is good. I think we just need to do better. So I'm trying my best to see if I can find some. Ooh, come on, I think I got something for us. I think I got something. Up here, where'd it go? Oh no, I think it moved, everybody. Hang on. Have a look in the middle of that spotlight over just a little bit down in there. There's a scorpion, everybody. Can you see that? There are the pincers sticking out. Look at that. Little scorpion hiding in the tree. Oh, wonderful. Just the pincers sticking out. Can you all see that? Now this looks like, so this species is called the Epistacanthus asper. They are tree creeping scorpions. Now these little scorpions rely on their powerful pincers. You can see that one. It's actually sitting there with its pincers open and it's waiting. You can see that bottom pincer especially is wide open. And what it uses that for is as insects walk past that hole, it will pick up on the vibrations of them. and they'll then rush out and grab it with its pincers. And they're incredibly fast and agile little creatures, these scorpions. And then they'll rely on their pincers to crush their prey, their insects, and feed on them. They do have a sting and they do have venom, but they don't use it as much, and not necessarily for killing their prey. They'll rely on the power of their pincers. So that's wonderful. There we go. We said we wanted to try to see a scorpion. And it's just hiding in there. But look, it's well hidden. There we go. You can see we're quite a distance from it. There we go, from this big tree. Oh, nice. Well, there we go. Nice to show you a scorpion on the first night drive back. There we go. Let's see. Now, come on, a chameleon. That would be great. I had guests recently. I actually take them on safari quite often, and it's so funny. The wife does not enjoy scorpions at all. She doesn't mind spiders, funny enough, but scorpions. But they're serious photographers, and the husband doesn't mind the little scorpions and the little creatures. So if I see one, I've got to always ask her to please look to the left so she doesn't see it, and then I'll show the husband the scorpion on the right to see if he'll photograph it. But she doesn't like to see them, so I've got to tell her to look the other way. It's very entertaining. I'm hoping, who knows, we might bump into a little genet or a civet or something running around. That would be wonderful. Kathy wanted to know how I saw that scorpion. Kathy, it's funny. So, I mean, obviously spending time out here, you become used to knowing what to look for, and to be honest, I learned all of that from a very good friend of mine and a tracker that I used to work with, a guy by the name of Judas. Him and I worked together for 5 years, and I worked permanently at a lodge, and Judas taught me so much about spotting little things and just great work, and we're still very good friends today, and I promise you, the things that he would spot at night, and he'd teach me what to look for and where to look. That's also the important thing, knowing where to look. So I learned all of that from him. So I need to thank Judas for his input. Judas has been tracking for 30 years, so his knowledge and experience is incredible when it comes to finding and looking for animals. And at night, people used to love going out with us because he'd always spot something interesting, whether it be little chameleons or snakes in the trees or scorpions. So I learned all of that from him. Need to look very carefully for these little chameleons, especially with some of the trees at the moment, very lush and green, so it would be difficult to spot them. I know we saw just before I went away or took that break, we did find two chameleons. James found one. I think he found the first one of the season. And then one drive we were on, Brian actually spotted one with me. So there were two seen 2 weeks ago. So they should be around. But it has been a bit cooler this last week, and they do prefer the warmth and the heat. That's generally when most of these reptiles come out. So hopefully we'll get to see some more. Oh, Caleb, you'd like to know what the temperature is at night. So this evening's a bit cooler, Caleb. So I would say we're in the 60s, probably Fahrenheit. I would say somewhere around there, maybe 65, 68. I would say the temperature's dropped to about that at the moment. And it's about probably 18 degrees Celsius, I think. It's difficult to say, but that's now, and this is very, it's been a very, very cool day. This overcast weather that we've had, it is not usual for this time of year. Usually it's very, very hot, so it's nice to have this cool weather. Some evenings, you know, in the middle of summer, it can still be about 30 degrees Celsius, which is very, very hot. It'll be a high 90s, I think. So, question from Sassy Survivor. You'd like to know how late you are able to stay out on safari. So, you know, you can, I mean, if you really wanted to, in some areas, and I say some areas, and I'll explain why, but in some areas, you can stay out all night if you want. It doesn't necessarily mean you're going to see things, but there's no time frame on a night safari. But generally, we stay out for about an hour or so after sunset. Most places it's an hour, hour and a half after sunset, just to see if there's any nocturnal movement, and if not, you head back to the camp. Also because some areas, national parks, and they do have strict rules about night drives, and they don't want people wandering around at night and getting lost, so generally there are strict rules about it. But luckily out here we can stay out a little bit. All right, still got a few minutes, so we're going to continue searching for little creatures. Let's head back to Brent and see if he's found anything.
Oh yeah, I just got a report from yours. There's a leopard right next to Inga's house. So I wonder if it is Karula, or could it be another leopard? Could it be Tingana? So we're right here now. There's yours's lights there. He's just lost visual, but the leopard was moving this way. There's an impala ahead, so turn the lights off. And there's impala and inyala all around here. There she is. Okay, I'm going to just show you. Yes, I've got her, and there's an impala and inyala between me and... between us, and she's just off to your left. Okay, VM, you can just probably... There we go, just a quick flash. That's where she is. There's an impala now. Let's turn this off, and I'll let VM, there we go, VM's gone into infrared. Oh, isn't this exciting? She's a bit far from infrared lights, but we can't move. She's right next, she's going for the Inyala, just keep on the Inyala. She's right behind the Inyala, just come a bit wider, VM. Just slow down, in a bit, she's going to pop out. I think, let's just stay with the Inyala. So if you can see Yorsa's lights, she's near that marula tree. It was the last place I saw her jogging to. Oh, sorry, my head's in the way. My fat head. I'll try to get out of the way now. Now, there's always a lot of general game around Inga's. And I think it'd be wonderful if she made a kill here. Because it means I could maybe even watch her from my bed. I've lost sight of her, but as you know, we're not going to use spotlights. We're going to stick with the infrared. Now, I almost half expect her to pop out just over here somewhere. Standing by yours. A negative, last place I saw her was directly between us, near that bush there. Okay, we can just make her out. As she popped out exactly where I expected. There she is. You can just see that movement. And that Inyala is... I can't see the Inyala anymore. But there's a bit of open ground between them, which could make it quite difficult. I'm not sure whether it's Karula. I don't know. We haven't obviously had a good look at this leopard yet. You still got any sights of her, VM? I'm just gonna put us into neutral and roll past the one bush so we can see. I don't know where she is now. Okay. I'm just gonna... There she is. There we go. She's popped out. I think she realized there's just too much open ground between her and... I'm not gonna put my light on her just yet because I haven't heard any alarm calls. So the Nyala and Impala are not aware she... Is it she? It looks like Karula. Of course, with this type of light, it's quite difficult. But just judging from the size, well, it's a female, but I think it's Karula. What do you think, Vim? Yes, Karula, the Queen of Juma. Well, Cataday has definitely delivered today. And she's done exactly what I said I hoped she would do. And that is head north, not south, in her hunt. So, Vim and I, we planned to hopefully find the nocturnal Karula, and we are lucky enough to... Actually, we need to thank Yors. Yors found it, found her actually at Inga's gate. So at the gate of the house that Jamie and I live in, that's where Yors saw her. Oh, no. What are you going to do now? Now, of course, hunting in an area like quarantine... It's very difficult for a leopard to hunt in very open area. She generally prefers thicker areas. I'm just going to have a quick look here. Tom, come as if you're going to Yuri's house, and we are just to the north and east of that junction that goes straight down to the Gallagher Pan. She's now just stopping and listening, seeing what's out there. Now there's often lots of impala and nyala, but again, this open country is very difficult for her to hunt in. Oh, someone spotted. Did you hear the snort? Game is up, Queen Karula. Okay. There we go. So we can put the lights on again. Now that she's been spotted. I wonder, I hope she hasn't, well, she hasn't definitely, but we've got a wonderful big male bushbuck that's been living in our garden. I'm glad she didn't find him. I'm quite fond of bushbuck, and particularly that chap. Okay, we're going to send you back across to Byron so you can say goodbye, and I'm going to get a bit closer to the Queen of Juma.
Isn't that so exciting, everyone? I'm so glad Brent managed to find Karula, and she is on the hunt, which is wonderful. I'm going to say goodbye to you. Thank you for joining us, everyone. It's been great to be back. Hope you enjoyed the afternoon with us. Thanks to Jandra on camera with me. And I will see you all tomorrow morning. Have a wonderful evening. Let's head back to Brent with Karula and see what she does before we leave you.
There we go. The Queen is on the move now. She looks like she's heading down towards the Mawati, now down towards Twin Dams Road, which is a much better hunting area for her in the thickets there. How's Tom? What? Here we go. So she might pop up on the Juma Dam cam in that direction that she's heading as well. Oh, she's disappeared behind a bush. No, there she is. So you can see how she didn't want to come out into the open, and she's preferring to move around the edge of the tree line. It's a much better hunting area for her. Okay, I'm going to move around to the other side to see where she pops out from. So I actually think she might stop at the Juma Pan for a drink. Well, it is wonderful having infrared as an option, and Judy absolutely loved that. And it does definitely add another dimension, Judy, that when we do find a leopard hunting, we don't all just sit in the dark. Well, we're sitting in the dark, but with the new technology, we're able to see, and that is an incredible thing. Oh, we've got a friend again. Have we lost the friend? Sounds like it. There she is, but what I want to do is actually go ahead to see if there's anything on the other side of her. Now, what I'm going to try, why I'm doing that is I'm going to try to get us into a position if she does stalk again. We're not going to be stuck behind her. We're actually going to be in a position that if she is going to go after an animal, we're going to be in the right spot. Now, one of the things when it comes to being out here is, and especially with safari guiding, and one of some of these tricks you learn the hard way, some you are often luckily taught by good teachers, is that you actually want to be ahead of the action. You want to predict what's going to happen before it happens, rather than being stuck behind. And of course, sometimes you can't help it, and with what happens. But in a situation like this, where I know there's another vehicle who's got her, I'm able to come up here and check to see if there's going to be anything she possibly might have the opportunity to stalk. And so that's why I'm jumping up ahead of her. Oh, there's lots of animals there. See, this is what I'm talking about. Getting yourself in the right position before something happens. And there's a water back there, so we're going to have to switch into IR again shortly. But there's a big herd, I thought, of impala. I'm just checking if they are. There we go, VM's going into IR mode. And here she is. She's coming towards us. Now, I don't think she's going to have a chance with those impala. They're right out in the open. Vim, just there, quickly. What's that? That looks like a honey badger. Sorry. I'm going on that side. Oh, it's gone. It's there. Was it a white-tailed mongoose? It's a genet. It's a little genet. Very far away. He's standing up. We're not something we see too often. Not the best view. It is very, very, very far away. Oh, Karula's right next to us as well. Sorry, Vim, everything's going on. She's going behind us. Okay, I'll pop to the side. You got her? There she is. But she's, oh, now she's stalking. Now, yeah, there's a waterback right next to her. Unfortunately, none of our IR lights can reach that spot. There we go, VM's playing some magic with the camera. And he's slowed it down. That's high ISO. Guys, just sorry, there's a water buck just on the other side of this bush here. Can we kill lights, please? Okay, so there's a water buck. I saw an adult female water buck. Unfortunately, our IR lights don't point in that direction, which is behind the car. So we're going to have to go old school and go in the dark. Listen. Yes, it looks, we're not black screen, don't worry. This isn't a tech issue. But we can come around. There we go. You can see I'm still here. Don't worry. We are just going to listen for a second. And I'm just going to often do is just do that. So there's a water buck. And there, just a quick glance across at everything. I think she's more stalking. It's an adult female water buck. I think it's a bit too far out of Karula's range. And also we want to give her the best chance possible. So it was where we could follow her easily. We followed her. She's now about to go into the gaps between the lodges. She might even go into the camp tonight. So I think we're going to leave her be. But fingers crossed that she is going to make a kill around camp and bring Hosan and Shungile this way rather than down south again. So from Vim and myself, it's been absolute pleasure having you on this cat today. And just remember, chin up with the Nkuhumas. It is nature, and fingers crossed it's going to get better. I truly hope so. But we'll see you tomorrow morning for the sunrise safari. It's been a joy.